Welcome back to another episode of the Digital Health and Wearables series. I have another magnificent guest for you today, but before we go ahead, make sure you subscribe, share all the great content with your communities in healthcare, and check out our global partners, Spirit Digital, with their magnificent digital health solution. But I'm extremely excited and delighted to have Tatyana Kanzaveli on the show today. She is the CEO at Open Health Network and also a very active voice in digital health. Tatyana, how are you?
I'm good. Thank you for having me on the show.
Now, thank you so much for accepting the invite. I know you were busy. We talking before the recording that you are busy. It's always good to be busy. So I hope you're keeping well and safe.
Yes, all good. Thank you.
Brilliant. So we're going to go straight to the questions. We both work in digital health, and the patient is often disregarded in the process. And what patient centricity really means?
Yeah, it's a real good question. It seems to me that patient centricity, we all talk about it. However, we can't agree on the definition. And I strongly believe that what patient centricity is looking at healthcare from truly patient point of view. Let me give you an example. My father had so many different health issues, from cardiovascular to diabetes, depression, you name it, had it all, right? However, the healthcare was set up to look at all his health issues from disease point of view, meaning that cardiologist was looking only at him as a cardiology patient, his, you know, urologist from urology and so on. So there were no integrated way of looking at all the health issues he passed away, but and I think this is kind of a fundamental way on how healthcare is set up. So we focused on disease per disease basis versus holistically looking at the patient in the context of all the kind of issues and environment that patient is in. Right. So from my point of view, it's fundamental to really move a needle in healthcare to reimagine and redesign healthcare to be truly patient-centered.
Tatyana, thank you so much. Thank you for sharing your personal example, and sorry to hear about your dad, but that's a very great example. It's very fragmented, isn't it? We look at one thing at a time, and great example. Thank you so much for sharing that.
Yeah, you're welcome. And I'm, you know, as you know, I started my company when I was diagnosed with cancer. And at that time, I kind of personally experienced disconnects within the healthcare, and I made it a mission for me to not just, you know, do random things in healthcare, but do and enable people who really care and visionary people to do things the right way. I understand that nothing happens overnight. You know, I worked with Fortune 50 companies at C-level to help transform enterprises across many different industries for many years in agile way from where they are, where they need to be. And I'm, you know, doing what I can to help with baby steps in healthcare to move things where they, I'm pretty sure they will end up where they need to be. It's just how fast we can get there.
Right. Thank you for sharing that. Maybe at the very beginning, I didn't give it enough accolade that you deserve, because you're very active. You have a very, very strong pedigree background. I know you are a keynote speaker. You are an influencer. And I know that you have this big vision. So we have that in common, but maybe I should say more things at the beginning. It's not just a job title. I know that you are on a mission to make impact. I know that. Let's go to the second question. The second question is, what do you think is needed to move the needle in healthcare in the United States, but also globally?
I will start with United States, because that's where, you know, I have most of my customers, and it took me a while to figure out all the, you know, details. And the more you dig into details, the more you realize how difficult it is to transform things. Because if you look at the way healthcare is structured in the United States, you have health insurance companies, you have pharma companies, you have specialty care, you have primary care physicians. So, and unfortunately, people are not in control of their healthcare, right? Health insurance in many cases tied to the employment, and then health insurance dictates who you can see, who you cannot see, how much they reimburse, the cost of care is high. So what we need to do at the highest level is see if there is a way to decouple. And actually, I am pro this notion of giving healthcare as a human right to people, because I think it's fundamentally wrong to force people to die if they don't have right health insurance to get right treatment and choose whether to eat or get treatment or lose their house and anything because of the cost of care. So I'm not talking about, you know, socializing healthcare per se, but at least the baseline should be available to everyone. Now, in terms of redesigning healthcare, I think we need to create cross-industry, cross-functional task force and really start reimagining in creating the solid to-be picture and then play it back to as is and build step-by-step model that can be executed to eventually get us to be. But from my point of view, we don't have integrated to be picture outlined yet. And that's the fundamental issues, because if you don't have that, you're making steps, but you don't know where they lead, you know, where it leads to.
Well, very, very important points that you mentioned. I mean, I'm Portuguese, but I live in UK, as you know. I'm fortunate to have the public, let's say, the public health system. But I know that in US, we have this discrepancy, and I don't really want to talk about socioeconomical classes. But you have, I think, the healthcare, the way it's structured in US, it really is elitist and creates a more it creates more barriers to those on the bottom, and it creates more disadvantages and gaps within the social economical classes, which I mean at some point you will be addressed. But I am with you that it should be at least a base level, an offer that everyone could access, and maybe technology and us, the people pushing our vision and our missions, maybe we can make that happen one day. But I believe that vision that you have for to have that baseline in place, it's much needed.
Yeah. And again, I think there is a need of integrated task force. So every single industry I worked with, and I worked with automotive, hospitality, oil and gas, high tech, manufacturing, across all the business processes, every time I'll get into new industry thinks that they're so unique and every single business process is so unique, and they tend to ignore lessons learned and experiences from other industries and business processes. However, from my point of view, being deeply inside many different, you know, corporations at very different you know, levels and looking at different business processes, there are more commonalities. And this, we tend to ignore those experiences and try to solve healthcare problems only within healthcare itself. We're not utilizing expertise and experiences in repeating mistakes that have been done before.
Oh, fantastic point, especially in terms of digital transformation piece as a whole. Fantastic point. Thank you. Moving on to the third and last question, and finally, how do you see the role of AI, artificial intelligence, in healthcare?
As you know, my background is technology, specifically AI and big data. And when I started my company, my main vision was how to get 360 degrees of data that impact causation treatment outcome of diseases, right? And when I look at that, I'm looking at massive multidimensional data sets. For example, like in my view, we will not get to the whole truth if we're just looking at subsets of data. And that's a fundamental issue. So if we're not looking in the context of what's your genetics, what's your environment, social economics, for example, what's the noise level where you live in, humidity, what type of food you eat, behavioral, and of course, you know, treatment and other things, and patient reported and data from, you know, devices if needed. If we're not creating and sharing all that data and analyzing it and building AI models, we will be always behind. We will not get a complete advantage of everything that we should be doing with AI and big data. And again, the deficiencies that, you know, we have so far, that we set up our healthcare in a way where our providers, in the quote, own our data. And that, you know, inherently makes them, you know, kind of creating jails with data, where we can't create centralized, clouds where we all can, play with all those data points. Some of the data we don't even capture. You know, I'm working with, fortunately, you know, some practitioners that are looking at, for example, for certain disease areas where we have sensors that get humidity levels and noise levels, and we use a variety of clinical grade devices and patient reported outcomes along with EMR data and everything else. But in most of the cases, that is not happening, right? And then we're limiting the use of AI, or whatever we get out of AI algorithm is narrowed. Mm-hmm. If you look at the outcomes, so I went and looked back at, I would say, the data that indicative of the state of the healthcare, the lifespan of, you know, in US is going down, it's not going up. So we're not improving the fundamental things that we're trying to improve, the healthier, longer lives of our people. So if with all those investments, all those technologies that have been happening, we're still, you know, kind of lagging on the ultimate result, we have to step back and say, so why? What's not happening? And I think AI and all those things, and of course, quality and availability of data will help us to actually do an impact.
Tatyana, fantastic. That is really fascinating. I mean, we could spend 1 hour, we came to the end of the show, but we could spend at least 1 hour on this last question and your thought process, and also your imagination and your identification of the real problem is fantastic. You made me laugh when you mentioned the jail of data, because people mention the silos of data, as you know, anyway. You made me laugh there, but there are some important issues. You mentioned the expectancy of life is not going up. So it's something that we're not doing right, or we could do more. We're not utilizing AI to the full capacity yet. Thank you so much for that. Tatyana, before I thank you for your participation and everything, we came to the end of the questions, but I finish all my shows in a peculiar way. It's not really a question. It's called 1 minute of fame. So you can talk about anything, a shout out to your company, personal life, professional achievements, anything, your family, anything whatsoever. So over to you, 1 minute of fame to round up.
Okay, I'll do it all. Again, thank you for having me on the show. I enjoyed talking to you. You know, my company, Open Health Network, we built a framework completely integrated, adaptive from care coordination management to patient-centered, mobile and integrated with sensors, devices, all the way around three back with embedded AI. So we're making difference in cardiology, rare diseases, autism, Alzheimer's, sleep, and so on. So proud to work with leading minds across many disease areas, and very hopeful that we will be able to get where we need to get, you know, in healthcare. In general, I am, innovator, you know, my background. I was, you know, chess champion, I love cooking. I like doing things that are uncomfortable. So I came up with this notion of doing one new thing that I haven't done before at least once a year. So from, you know, windsurfing to whatever those things are. And I think having that kind of approach to life, I strongly believe we underestimate, you know, your brain, your state of mind, to how, you know, your health and everything else. It's all interconnected, right? So I feel that, you know, if we stimulate and set up those amazing, difficult, uncomfortable goals for ourselves, we keep ourselves, you know, young, if you will. So I wish, you know, all the people to try to do things that are uncomfortable, that are different, and enjoy them and push yourself every single day. I think that's what life is about. Don't delay. Don't say, oh, okay, no, I can't do it now, because you always will have reasons why you cannot do things. So just do them.
Brilliant. Tatyana, thank you so much. I seen some of the posts of the cooking, your exciting stuff. So I encourage people to follow you. Thank you so much, Tatyana. Thank you so much for your time, for your expertise, the great things that you shared. And I'm going to post your Twitter, your company in here, your LinkedIn. Make sure everybody check Open Health Network and connect with Tatyana. Tatyana, before I round up, thank you so much again.
Thank you. Have a good day.
And to all our listeners and followers, make sure you subscribe, share this magnificent content, connect with Tatyana, and check Open Health Network and also Spirit Digital. And I'll see you all next week.